Welcome back. You're still watching Indian Open with us on Bloomberg. Quinn, let's quickly do a check of what the Asian market indices this morning are doing. Well, Nikkei has seen good gains of nearly 300 points coming about. Hang Seng has rebounded a little bit today, up almost 140 points in trade, but still some bit of weakness still persists for Shanghai market. That's down 0.5%. Let's see what the SGX Nifty is doing today. And that's sitting with gains of almost 26 points. It was an historic day for our markets yesterday, where Sensex touched all-time high levels and Nifty reclaimed the 11,000 mark. So what sort of cues we are getting from the derivatives market? Let's head across to Agam Vakil to find out the same. And Agam, the base for the market is now moving higher. We've seen higher level put strikes adding open interest.
As one might expect, Navneet, because we were firmly above the mark of 11,000 when it comes to the Nifty. Let's take a look at the futures and see where we've seen open interest traction. And yes, we have seen about a 3.5% addition in OI, even as the Nifty moves ahead. What about the Nifty banking index? That also moved up by as much as 0.8%, but very little change in open interest, as you can see here. Let's move on and take stock of the Nifty put call ratio, and that has also edged up higher to around 1.73. This is the mark around which a lot of your analysts will tell you that it's time to start getting cautious. And moving on, let's also take a look at where we've seen a movement in your options. So we're starting to see a little more writing around the 11,000 put, which this is given the fact that we saw the Nifty move about that mark, and the same for the 10,900 put as well. On the other hand, unwinding coming along in the 10,900 call, given the fact that some would unwind and take profits out of the 10,900 call. But that said, we're starting to see a little more writing around the 11,200 mark, and which I suspect will provide some amount of resistance in the near term. As I said, let's take a look at some of the stocks. And in new and banned, we have Jet Airways, and among other stocks that we are watching out for. We also have something like an IDBI bank, which is out of the ban. And, you know, in terms of traction, Arvind stands out, considering we saw strength come through, another 16% added in open interest towards fresh longs. Moving in, we also have Marico, which is in focus. We've spoken about it this morning, fresh longs coming in there as well. And among several other stocks where we are watching out for, you have UPL. This is on the losing end, making a new 52-week low, more weakness coming through, even as the stock tumbles by as much as 4%, 5% added towards fresh shorts. So some weakness in UPL, but otherwise the markets are looking good at this point in time.
Interesting. Thanks a lot for that, Agam. Thanks for putting that into perspective. Hey, Navneet, just wondering, the conversations that we were having the last two or three days is about the kind of why that was building up on the call side at the 11,000 strike. Yes, right. I was seeing your mail. There is some OI pullback that happened on the 11,000 strike on the call side in trade yesterday. Naturally expected. The question is, what if the market continues further? What's the quantum of OI still existing at the 11,000 call?
Neeraj, we spoke about this in the morning, that if Nifty reclaims the 11,000 mark, you'll see the call writers running for cover because they would be making losses. And then that's exactly what happened. We did see unwinding to the tune of almost 4 to 5 lakh shares coming for the 11,000 strike. And that was a strike which was sitting with maximum open interest. As of now, also, that still exists with almost closer to 38 lakh shares, but now that open interest is shifting to 11,100 and the 11,200 strike. But if one were to watch the upside level, it has to be the all-time high mark of 11,171 now on the index. But open interest is now shifting to the 11,100 and the 200 strike. I think the most positive cues that we've got this week is FIs have turned now net long on index futures. The ratio is 51%. They've added 50,000 contracts in the last four trading sessions itself. And also the sort of put riding, which is shifting to higher levels. If you look at the premium on 11,000 put, Neeraj, it's 80.85. That's telling you they're writing that put because no smart money will ever buy that put. Yeah. So these are the positive signs. The PCR is going up. Your FIQs have been positive so far this week. And unwinding on the call side is always a good sign.
Yeah, well, let's wait and watch. And the levels might well drive the activity on those strikes as well. But because for now, while the trend is your friend, it certainly caught a lot of people by surprise. Not too many people would have anticipated five strong days. And with the global markets doing what they're doing, may well be in for one more. in the session today. Let's wait and watch. Okay, before we move any further, though, it's 8:35, around the time when we get you, our research team members, to tell us about all the key stocks and news in our research huddle. So let me walk across to our team and try and figure out what is it that they want to highlight. Some stocks and news, a couple of results that have come out, and maybe some brokerage notes or otherwise. Nikki, Shraddha, as well as Agam yet again. Shraddha, let's start off with you first.
So NCLT has approved the demerger of Tata Communications and Hemisphere Properties India. We could see some up move on the back of more of a sentiment reaction for Tata Communications. Vakrangi has entered into an alliance with Reliance Nippon Life Asset Management to offer mutual fund distribution services. HOEC has said that they've completed drilling campaign of two wells in PY1 block, which has led to increase in the gas production. You have a ET report which has said that KKR-controlled Avendis has emerged as a front runner to buy IDFC mutual fund. They've said that they are offering anywhere between 3 to 4,000 crores. In a bulk deal in Gayatri project, Goldman Sachs Singapore has bought 1.34% stake. The seller is Next Orbit Ventures Fund, which is an existing investor. It's a near exit for this fund. And Nat Biogenes, where Goldman Sachs Singapore has bought 2.63% stake. The seller is investor Sanjay Dangi's Mentor Capital. So let's see how those names react.
Very interesting. Thanks a lot for that, Shraddha. And as I've been saying since morning, IT remains firmly in focus. We spoke to Urmil about what the expectation reactions on both Cyient and HCL Tech could be. But Agam, but I've spoken to a bunch of people, analyzed a bunch of reports. What is the consensus first on HCL Tech?
Okay, so I'm going to start off with what the HCL Tech buyback comprises of. It's worth 4,000 crores. It's at around 1,100 rupees per share, and that's at a roughly 10% premium to the current market price. That said, the equity that is expected to be bought back is coming to around 3.63 crores, roughly 2.6%. And, once again, do remember this is slightly higher than the buyback, which was carried out last year at around 3,500 crores. This time it's around 4,000 crores. And again, a lot of brokerages don't have too much to say about the buyback, except for the fact that it's largely, on expected lines. And at around 1,100, that is also not too much of a surprise. So that's as far as the HCL Technologies buyback is concerned. And moving on to Cyient, earnings, and as we've spoken about, well, mixed earnings. To a certain extent, weak, considering we've only seen a 1.7% uptick sequentially for Cyient. On the other hand, we've seen substantial contraction in margins at around 9.4% as against 11%. And consequently, we've seen profits come off by as much as 32% sequentially. The reason behind this is a slowdown in certain projects, as the management has suggested. On the other hand, when it comes to the aerospace and defense segment, where the company gets over 30% of its revenues from, that has seen double-digit growth. So one of the few positives in the earnings. However, when it comes to design-led manufacturing segment, that's the emerging segment that has seen seasonal weakness. So on the whole, it's not been such a great quarter for Cyient, and we're going to have to wait and watch whether or not this trend continues as we move into the next few quarters.
Yeah, thanks a lot for that, Agam. And IT isn't, we are not listening, hearing the last of IT, isn't it? I think Deutsche has a report on them.
It has covered, initiated coverage on three counters, but I'm going to give a rundown of what it says about the sector first. It says that the shift to digital is going to be unlike the previous technology transition. Skills and not scale is expected to drive next leg of growth. They expect INR depreciation as a tactical tailwind and see sector-wide. However, they expect the sector-wide growth outlook to remain muted. However, to overcome these challenges, acquisition and partnership, however, will hold the key. For TCS, they've initiated a hold rating with a target price of 1,740, which indicates a potential downside of 12%. For Infosys, it's a buy. They've initiated a buy rating with a target price of 1,495 with a potential upside of 15%, whereas they say they see a potential upside of a modest 7% for HCL Technologies, where they've initiated a buy with a target price of around 1,070.
Well, if you were to believe them on a tactical basis, there is a 27% differential if you enter into a pair trade. Thanks a lot for that, Nikki. Let's pose that question to Yogesh Mehta. He joins us right now from Motilal Oswal. Yogesh, good having you. Thanks much for joining in. Let me start off with that. IT right in the hunt currently. What is it that you guys have been telling your clients to do in the last few days between TCS, Infosys, which comes out with numbers today, and maybe when HCL Technologies?
Neeraj, good morning. Since IT is in flavor nowadays, since last 15-20 odd days, the large cap and the mid-cap IT rally had started 2-3 months back. So here the tailwind is, of course, from the USD INR side, which is at around 69 rupees. So that has given some margin uptick into the quarterly numbers this time. TCS we had been recommending since the buyback offer has been announced. So that is the core primary of our recommendations for the IT companies in the large cap. Secondly, it is by Infosys, and third, HCL Tech. We have a neutral rating, even though the buyback offer has been announced up to 4,000 crores, which will have a 40% PAT outgo from the last year buyback offer, and this time again it is a 40% PAT outgo. So that shows that a reduction in equity capital, but still HCL Tech is on a neutral side. We see some headwinds in the business right now. And Infosys and the TCS, these are the two recommendations which you are giving. And Infosys is the result date today. So we would be watching out for the result, because the expectation is around a little less than 3,800 crores. So let's see what would the BFS and the retail segment commentary would be from the management side. And INR would be a tailwind again for them, but the wage hike and all will have a set-off effect. So yet we believe that EBITDA margin for Infosys should be somewhere around 24.1%, beating a guidance of 22-24% by the management.
Okay, we'll be watching out for Infosys numbers. But Yogesh, the other stock which has been in focus is Reliance Industries. Yesterday's gain was primarily the contribution which came in on Nifty front, came in from the biggie Reliance Industries, and it also reclaimed its $100 billion mark. I don't know how much to read into that number, because last time when it touched, rupee was 39.5, and the market cap that time was somewhere about 4.5 lakh crore. We're comfortably sitting around the mark of 6.8 now when it comes to the market cap of Reliance Industries. I think, but what the street wants to know, what now for Reliance Industries, considering we've seen the rally, but this is a stock which has been under-owned for quite a long time.
Since Reliance has got the largest family shareholders, but there's always been a competition between TCS and Reliance since last 2 years that who will be number one in the market cap. And TCS has outperformed significantly this time. So again, back into the race by Reliance, with again a tailwind by the GRM margin, which would inch up further, because the crude price have softened again now. So that has fueled some more interest from the traders community as well as the investors to have a defensive kind of a large cap company into the portfolio, because mid cap and small caps are having laggards. So the fund activity is more towards the large cap peer companies within the top notch, within the top 20. They are active in 5 to 7 stocks only to have the alpha on the returns. So that is the perseverance we have. So again, coming back to the fundamentals of the Reliance, that post Jio, the annual AGM. Now we have revised post the subscriber number, which has crossed 200 million. So that is the Jio price into equity value, where we have raised from 215 to 255 rupees. And the GRM margin on the Singapore GRM margin will improve further. So we believe that global peers are quoting at around 7.8 to 8 times EV to EBITDA. So here Reliance, we are projecting that at least 7.5 or 7.4 EV to EBITDA, even though there is a still upside on a longer term basis. But a recent uptick into the stock price, which has come up by 5% in a day. So that has come as a surprise because of the just a buoyancy from the fund houses and the HNIs to have that flavor of the stocks.
For sure. Certainly seems to be the case the last few days. A scant regard to the kind of rally that we've already seen in Reliance Industries. Yogesh, the slight pullback in crude prices, how are you reading into it? More importantly, for the oil marketing companies, BPHP, IOC, I mean, with this post the correction and post the correction in crude prices, do they offer a chance for an investor?
See, Neeraj, there are too many flip-flops for the crude price and OMC company. Now, the margin will remain skewed between 2 to 2.3 rupees per liter for these companies. The volumes are improving by 6.5 to 8% YOY. But it seems that a crude price will again play a spoil spot if it moves up 80. So investor with intrinsic value at this point in time, we don't believe that if crude comes down to 60, it is again fine. But what if goes above 80? So investors will have a sleepless nights if they go in, if they invest into these companies. But around 250, 260, we would suggest that yes, they can go for it. But then there is every now and then they will have to watch out for the crude prices. Whatever developments has happened over global trade war, we come out with every state every now here and every now and then about the statement from the U.S. president. So if there is something again on the crude price with the Iran import ban again to India and the surrounding countries, so it will have a bad impact on the stock price again. As of now, with corresponding everything into the price, it could provide a good opportunity for investors around 260, 270, because already stock has corrected more than 50%. So can buy gradually, not at it's not a gung-ho investment rationale right now.
Okay, that's the view coming in on the oil marketing companies. And also remember, the aviation stocks were up in yesterday's session, reason being the correction that one had seen for the Brent crude prices. Let's also get you some technical check going on the markets now. We've got our technical experts ready here. Shrikant Chauhan, Senior Vice President for Technical Research at Kotak Securities. And also joining us is Raja Venkataraman, Chief Technical Analyst at Chart Advice. Good morning to both of you, gentlemen. Shrikant, let me come to you first and take your view on Nifty. We reclaim the 11,000 mark. I know the street would be eyeing for the all-time high level of 11,171. Considering the volatility is on the lower side, the cues we are getting is positive from the derivatives market. PCR is inching higher. But at any point, do you think the markets are overbought?
I think, see, the way the markets this time moved up, and always in the first month of the quarter, we see such kind of activity. If you see the track record of last 2-3 years, then most of the time, means I think almost 90% time, the market gained on the first month of the quarter, maybe on the back of results and all. But this time the move is like much sharper than expectations. It was around 10,600 when the Nifty had started its expiry. From there all the way we see we saw the levels of 11,100, which is very close to previous high. So yes, we can expect 11,150, 170 on the higher side, but we cannot like means we have to give more weightage to the all-time highest levels, because in the year 2010, if you remember, the market failed to conquer its new high by just 20 points. So it was around 6,300. From there all the way, it fallen to the levels of 4,500. Again, in the year 2016, the story repeated. Market was very close to 9,000. It dropped, missed that level by some 20, 30 points, and again fallen to 7,800 levels. So we have to give weightage to 11,150, 170, which is all-time highest level. But at the same time, at this point of time, the way the structure is there, if there is any correction, we should look for adding long positions. We can again expect 11,150, and I think now 10,950, 900 is going to act as a support.
Mm-hmm. Raja, how are you approaching trade currently? For somebody, let's say, who's missed the bus until now, because this rally has caught a few people by surprise.
Definitely, yeah.
What does he or she do now? Does he play on the long side, or does he play on the long side with a bit of a dip? When a bit of a dip comes in?
Yeah, so what really has been driving the markets has been the large caps.
While, concentrated, yes.
Yeah, there's concentrated action on the large caps, and especially led in the forefront by Reliance, and the other large caps too are participating. And the large cap movement has actually driven everyone towards the positive side. And with the positive outflow emerging from the results, the positive momentum has built up, and the cautious levels which we were highlighting in the last few weeks, around 10,850 zone, that has overcome. And that will now become the new base. So having said that, if the prices are going to continue further, then there has to be some positive influences. But if the results from these large caps may offer some kind of, if it's not meeting the expectations, like for example, Reliance is expected not to be as good as TCS. So it's beginning from today. So if it does offer a pullback, one should actually use that pullback to actually enter into the market. Mm-hmm. Because markets are definitely on the positive side. So we are looking for a target of around 11,200. And even from the weekly charts, if you observe, then if the market closes where it is closing today, it will have the highest weekly close over the past so many weeks. So what it would do is, according to technical parlance, it would definitely incur further upward traction, and it could exceed the previous high of 11,150. So that will make it a good scenario for everyone to participate.
I must say though that the last few days, I mean, I've been back from a small break only in the last 4 days.
Correct.
The conversations have ceased to be around the Nifty Bank. We've actually been led higher without arguably some of the heaviest names participating. The HDFC twins have been well, almost missing from action. I haven't heard a single call on HDFC or HDFC Bank in the last 4 days. So we've done this despite the banks not being at the forefront because of Reliance, TCS and some of the others.
Yes.
The question mark only is what if banks participate, right? Because the Nifty Bank, we haven't seen any calls at least
this
in the last
week,
4 days.
No, Neeraj. Yes. But overall, if you were to see the gains that we've seen from the lows,
they have to participate,
definitely.
Obviously.
But yes, stocks like ICICI Bank and State Bank of India have not rallied so much the way markets have rallied this
week.
Yeah,
so it'll be interesting to see what happens if those come back into the play as well. Just wondering, before we get to Jayesh on Bloomberg Edge, Raja, quick thought here. Yeah. Will you trade the Nifty Bank at all?
Yes, I would, because 26,800 was a strong resistance zone and it has crossed that level. So I would definitely be a buyer in Nifty Bank.
Okay.
Just one.
Okay, yeah. We'll come to Srikanth as well on this, but it's 8:50, that time of the show, where we should get Jayesh Kinlani. It's the time for our special segment, Bloomberg Edge, wherein he tells us about a pattern that the terminal has thrown up on a stock or an asset class. Jayesh, is it a stock on your radar today?
Morning, Neeraj. Yes, it's Voltas that the Bloomberg Terminal has in fact thrown up, and for good reason as well, because the stock has recently bounced back from key levels that it had touched in the last 1 year, and with yesterday's close, it has also managed to surpass the 50-day moving average for the first time in about a couple of months. And the trender indicator, which is a proprietary Bloomberg indicator, that has also given a buy signal. So confluence of factors playing out with Voltas. But first, let's have a look at how the trender actually works and what's the theory behind it. It's a proprietary Bloomberg indicator, and it uses the average true range as one of the key inputs for calculation behind the indicator. Not only does it help you to generate buy and sell signals, but also helps you to place where the stop loss should be for your trade. And the buy and sell signals are very easy to interpret, because you have to follow the color of the indicator. When it turns from red to green, that's when you buy. And when it turns from green to red, that's when you sell. But there's a buy indicator on Voltas. Now you can see the yesterday's close that is there. So the red line is the trender indicator, which was acting as a resistance for Voltas. But yesterday's close, it has been surpassed. So there is a buy signal on the cards for Voltas.
Interesting. Jayesh, what's the past indicator or backtesting suggest? And you mentioned that the trender helps you keep a stop loss as well. What's the stop loss that the trender is indicating?
So Neeraj, the stop loss will come into play today after the market opens below on the chart over here somewhere. Based on the calculations, there will be a green dot. So that green dot, while I don't know where the market will open, but after the market opens, there'll be a green dot over here. That will be your stop loss. And as far as backtesting is concerned, last 1 year has shown about a 12% profit rate for the entire of last year and all the trades that have been generated.
Okay, so the returns are almost 12%, over 12% on Voltas when you follow the trender indicator. Jayesh, thanks for putting that into perspective. Let's wait and watch Voltas. It's come out of the brink, really. You haven't seen too much of Voltas being discussed. But, well, maybe you never know. That's when the stock might make a move, a bit of a surprise move. Specific stocks, Srikanth, if you want to just dwell a little bit on the Nifty Bank, if you trade that one, and then your stock recommendations for the day today.
See, Bank Nifty also yesterday, it was like interesting pattern. It was very close to 27,170, which was the level on the 31st of May, Bank Nifty has registered. And that day, we saw a good amount of activity in stocks like HDFC Bank and other private banks. Okay, that we saw some 5-7% kind of activity. Now, what I'm saying is that till the Bank Nifty is not crossing 27,170, it is going to remain under pressure. But above 27,170, we can expect technical breakout. So in that case, we will take long call on Bank Nifty. Okay.
Stocks, Srikanth?
Stock specific, yes. We like Mahindra & Mahindra, which close around 920, 915 levels. And here also the formation is very clear. It is into trending mode. It's trending upward. Stop loss level is very nearby. 895 should be the stop loss to initiate long positions. And we can see the levels of 940, 950 on the higher side. The other stock which we like is DLF. Some few days back, 2-3 days back, the stock has entered into some breakout mode, and now it is again corrected to its support area. So from here, if we keep stop loss at 185, I think that should do well, because now if there is any participation to come, then it should come from those stocks which have not participated till now. So DLF looks good, and we are expecting 195, 196 on the higher side.
Okay, so those are two calls coming in from Srikanth. Remember, Mahindra and Mahindra was weak yesterday, but we've been receiving a lot of technical buy calls on this one, at least in the last 5 to 6 trading sessions. Raja, what about you? Individual stocks you're betting on?
Yeah, I'd be going for the IT space. That's the flavor right now. And from that, I would like to select from the mid-cap IT space, KPIT. because KPIT has been really holding on to the highs, and yesterday towards the end of the day we saw good momentum coming in play, and I would like to go long in KPIT at current levels with the stop loss around say 291, and we have an upside around 310 in KPIT.
Okay.
And so the other stock I would recommend from the finance pack, which with Bajaj Finance, so one could look to hold on to it and trade on a intraday as well as a positional basis, because we can expect 100 rupees upside from here.
Bajaj Finance, yeah, we did see some strength in that counter yesterday.
No, I heard Raja said that hold on to that stock, but I was wondering if somebody doesn't have a position, can he buy it?
I'm saying intraday or intraday. Positional. You can
initiate a fresh buy.
Yeah, you can initiate a fresh buy.
There was some action seen on the futures side. I was just checking the data. There were fresh long seen for that one. Just one stock, a lot of our viewers want to view on Arvind. I think in the second half of the session, that stock went up. There were fresh long seen on the futures side. One of our viewers wants to know, can they look too short? I don't know what the trend is on the chart. So if somebody is holding a position, what should be the levels? And would you advise anyone to short at higher levels?
Navneet, see, like Arvind is very clearly into complex structure. It is not like trending, not at all like it is moving higher or moving down. So it is range-bound stock, and till the stock is not coming closer to the levels of 440, 450, I think stay away from taking any short positions. At the same time, the stock is having very good support close to 385, 390. So in case if it falls to 385, 390, it's a best buy. And avoid shorting, because the stock overall, if we see, I think this space is going to do well in next 6 months. So we are specifically bullish on Raymond, Arvind, Mill, Bombay Dyeing. And if there is any correction, we are advising our clients to take long positions with a medium to long term view.
So not too short it?
So not too short. But if really like somebody wants to short on an intraday basis, then I think 440, 450 is the level. Sure.
Interesting. Yogesh, I want you to comment on Bajaj Finance at 2400, near all-time highs, a stock on the back of a rally which just doesn't come off. Can somebody make a fresh investment here? It's not cheap stock, but it's a stock which is showing growth.
Yeah, Neeraj, see, though the price has run up almost 10%, 12% in last 3-4 sessions, but if somebody wants to invest as, you know, defensive stock with the comfort on the investment side with the lesser risk at this point in time for at least 1 year, then Bajaj Finance can be looked at. However, expensive valuations are still there, and the price as the price moves higher, the expensive valuation becomes more expensive. But on the defensive side, rather than getting into any of the smaller mid-cap companies where investor does not have any clue, so rather than that, on the defensive side, one can have this Bajaj Finance in the portfolio, because still we believe that at least 45-47% CAGR of AUM growth would be there for next 2 years, FY19 and 20 as well. So that foresight reason of that growth is still there, and the correction is not there is no correction visible, at least in this kind of a market, then certainly investors can go for that.
Okay, I don't think Neeraj is anyone on the street who says not to have stocks like Bajaj Finance, though we are trending higher in terms of, you know, only frontline indices. But the calls that we've been receiving from a lot of the experts who come on the show are the stocks which are quoting premium valuation, be it from the FMCG pack or from the likes of IndusInd, HDFC Twins, from the financial and banking pack. And Bajaj Finance is one of them.
Yeah, and also, Navneet, the reason why actually all of us do this, right, ask people day in and day out regularly about these stocks, because there is probably merit in owning them, because those are the ones which are showing growth. The tendency of for a lot of people would be that, oh, the stock has run up about 20-30% from in the last 2-3 months, now it's a bit expensive, let's not go out and buy it. But it's not expensive because the future earnings make the stock a lot cheaper. I'm not saying that's the case for Bajaj Finance. It is a terribly expensive stock which is showing growth.
I think the expectation from future earnings is still buoyant when it comes.
He's guiding to 40% every year for the next 2-3 years.
Yes,
that is terrific run rate.
Yeah, so let's see whether these stocks quoting premium valuations. You also had HUL touching lifetime highs almost every day, something like Britannia from the FMCG pack. And all these stocks have been the theme, at least in the recent past. Very quickly, Raja, any view on UPL, a Nifty constituent which has been falling for the last two sessions?
UPL actually has broken its near-term low, and the momentum has definitely been to the downside. And the overall setup, the technical setup does look more weakish, and from here, we could expect even a further decline towards 555, where we see some set of supports emerging. So one should actually be trading on the short side in UPL, because despite the markets moving up, there is continuous short pressure being witnessed. and there are long body candles which are being displayed, definitely indicates a lot of bearish sentiment in the stock.
Okay, and that's what we've been seeing actually when it comes to the stock price of UPL. At least in the last two sessions, we've seen a correction of nearly 9 to 10% for this counter. But few seconds to go for the pre-opening rates to come up on your screen. Remember, SGX Nifty is suggesting an uptick of almost 24 points. The cues that we are getting from the Asian market indices, even the handover from US was quite positive. So we are looking at a positive start. 11,070 is the rate, initial pre-opening rate, but remember these rates will settle down in a while. Sensex quoting an uptick of nearly 150 points at the moment. In case if we trend higher in today's session, do keep an eye on all-time high level mark of 11,171. But let's do a check for Nifty constituents, what's happening there. HCL Technologies, that's going to be the stock in focus after the buyback which has been announced worth 4,000 crore. So that's showing an uptick of 4% in the pre-opening session at levels of 1,045. Remember, it's come in at a premium of almost 20% to yesterday's closing. Coal India is showing an uptick of 2%. You've got something like Aisha Motors, Ultratech Cement that are showing a bit of positive ticks, at least in the pre-opening rates. SBI, on the flip side, is down almost 1.3%. Infosys, which will be coming out with its numbers today. Remember, Infy was weak in yesterday's session. Today also, it's showing a downtick of almost 1%. UPL, once again, in the pre-opening session is just about flat to negative, but pull up Reliance Industries. I think we will be monitoring that stock as well, considering it rose almost 4 to 5% yesterday. So just about a flat opening, pre-opening rate actually coming about for Reliance Industries. And pull up Cyient too, which will be reacting to the numbers which were on the weaker side. Cyient in the pre-opening session is showing a downtick of nearly 3%.
You know, the interesting move is in the rupee, vis-a-vis the dollar, a pullback in today's session as well. And I think now it's what strengthened almost 0.3%, 68.34 now for the currency in a matter of 2 days. From 68.80 or thereabouts, we're back to 68.34. So dramatic uptick. I use the term dramatic with reason because the dollar has been by and large strengthening against almost all the other currencies, including the yen and a few others. But the rupee, the last couple of days, there's a bit of a pullback. I don't know if there's intervention or some specific reasons, but the rupee certainly pulled back in the session. What about the bond yields? Bring those up also for you. 7.78. So there's some bit of a pullback in the bond yields too. From 7.90 day before yesterday, we're now at about 7.78. So keep in mind these two factors as well. The markets are starting off on a good note. Just a couple of mid-caps that I want to highlight. There's some unnatural rates in Reliance Infra. I think these will change. It was up 9%, now about 6%. It'll probably change a bit. A stock that's done really well the last four or five sessions is GVK Power. Fourth day on a trot now, or fifth day on a trot, that GVK Power is up and about another 4.7% from almost sub 10. GVK Power now is about 12-odd% higher in trade. So good going for GVK Power in the session today. What's not doing well is Manpasan Beverages down another 5%, Quality down another 3.5%. And I reckon the Hathaways and the Den Networks of the world too would be in a corrective phase currently. Cyient is the last one that I want to mark very quickly before I go across and try and get you one what brokerages are saying in the session today too. Also probably try and tell you what mutual funds have done. But Cyient, 8.5% of a downtick. Okay, all over the place. Remember, IDBI Capital said that while there's a bit of a disappointment, it still remains a good stock to own. We'll ask Yogesh about this right now. All over the place right now, Cyient, but must say, it was a weak quarter. The only thing is, if the tide is rising, which is everybody's buying mid-cap IT, even weaker hands tend to have falls which are cushioned. And let's see if the same happens to Cyient or not. Too early to say. Just the first 3 minutes. Let's wait for the next 5 minutes to settle down as well. Since we're on the topic of Cyient, Yogesh, do you guys at Motilal Oswal track Cyient? And if so, what's the call today on Cyient after the disappointment that we've seen in the results that came out yesterday?
Yeah, Neeraj, we do have coverage on Cyient, and it was in line with expectation because the DLM and NSEM both have been integration of that has taken place. And the margin contraction has happened over 2%, which is largely led by we can say that it would be again project delayed in utility sector. So that has dragged the profitability and the wage hike both together. So there it seems that with the ROE of 16-17% and it will be trading at around 16-17 times P multiple, growth comeback of growth would be a delayed one, because a lot many things would be dependent on the future course of action on the defensive side, which may take a little long time. So we believe that stock may react today, and the upside would be by FY20 we are cutting our estimate and would be 780 rupees, 17 times FY20 EPS. So probably stock may react on the will react on the negative side today.
Okay, that's signed for you, showing a downtick of nearly 3%. But since we're on the topic of earnings, private sector lender Karnataka Bank reported a stable quarter one earnings. The bank has reported highest ever quarterly profit this time around with a growth of nearly 22%. The growth was mainly driven by improvement in its asset quality. So what are the growth prospects going ahead? Let's ask the management of the company. MD and CEO of the company, Mahabaleshwar AMS, joins us on the show now. Mr. Mahabaleshwar, good morning to you and thanks a lot for joining us. Congratulations on posting highest ever quarterly profit this time around. If I overall look at the earnings, the NPAs, the asset quality has improved a bit. There's been a bit of reduction in slippages too. If you could tell us what were the major highlights that has contributed to stable set of numbers in the first quarter of FY19?
Yeah, the first one is business numbers. See, both deposits, advances and turnover. Advances, we have been able to get a traction of around 24.28%. Turnover is, business turnover has gone up by 16.72%, whereas the deposits have gone up by 11.56%. Apart from these business numbers, we have also been able to focus very well on asset quality, because the credit cost, which was at 0.51% about a year back, has now come down to 0.41%. And of course, in the previous quarter, it was one of the highest at 1.25. So NPA provision during the quarter also, it has slightly moderated. So of course, the previous quarter, that is as of March 2018, we had 590.38 crores, whereas it has drastically come down to 193.78 crores during the current quarter. And about a year back, it was at 196.59%.
Right.
We have been focusing on the stress management, especially the S2 and S3 accounts, that is the delinquency of 60 days and above, as well as the 30 days and above. And as you all know that we have already embarked upon our transformation journey with BCG, and we are now putting in place a very comprehensive collection mechanism. So that on pilot basis, we have already run it, and there has been a very significant success in that collection mechanism. And all India, we will be rolling it out by this month end. So that is why I'm optimistic about maintaining our asset quality going forward.
Okay, but what about the future growth prospects? Would you be able to maintain the run rate? First quarter has been all about moderating the asset quality. We've seen a reduction, but it's a slight reduction. Going forward for the entire year, if you could give us a guidance, how will the asset quality pan out? And also, will you be able to maintain the run rate of the NI of 10% that we've seen, which is coming at 468 crores?
Yeah, NII and operating profit, I think I am on a strong foot. NII has gone up by 10.40%, whereas operating profit has gone up by 19.11%. So as our CD ratio is one of the highest since 1948, and we should be able to maintain that CD ratio as well as the asset quality. If those two things are taken care of, definitely NII as well as the operating profit, and of course the bottom line, we should be able to maintain. As far as the NPA is concerned, the gross NPA also has since slightly moderated from 4.92% as of March 2018 to 4.72%, and net NPA also from 2.96% to 2.92%. Internally, we have been working hard to contain it at around 4.4% for the NPA, mm-hmm, and at around 2% for NPA.
Okay, so would you believe, Sir, would you believe since we are very close to market open, I have slightly limited time, and therefore I just want to get in a couple of numbers. Do you believe that this number of the contain that the level that you want to contain the NPAs at, would that be the average for FY19? And just one number, the GNPA divergence for FY17, I reckon, was in the range of 1100 crores. Where does it stand right now?
There will not be any divergences because we have been proactive in recognizing the stress in the portfolio. So as I said, we are totally focused on containing the slippages and improving the quality of the assets. And that is why we have been very careful in asset acquiring activities also. So going forward, since all the preventive mechanism have already been in place, so we should be able to sustain this type of performances going forward.
Which is heartening to know. What's the strategy for Universal Sompo? I believe in the Q4 analyst meet, you mentioned that you would be open to selling the stake if the opportunity is right.
We had offered it, and we have also received IRDA guidelines. But we are in the process of finding the right valuation for that stake.
Would it be fair to assume, sir, that we are nowhere close to the deal getting consummated? It's probably a quarter away, at least, if not more.
There are so many regulatory requirements to be fulfilled, so it depends.
Okay. My last question, sir, would the asset quality, as you mentioned, the GNPA, you're targeting 4.4, if I'm not wrong, that's the number that you mentioned, you are hoping to contain it at that level. Do you reckon that that would be the average for FY19?
Around 4% and around 2%, plus or minus 20 to 30 basis points.
Okay. Would have loved to chat more, sir, but we're just getting ready for the markets to kickstart trade, so we'll have to leave it at that. But all the best for the year. Really hope you do better
Thank
than
you.
That as well.
Thank you.
That's Karnataka Bank. Bring up the stock for you. Just pull Karnataka Bank up on the screen, marginally off in trade. Yogesh, a quick thought here. Do you guys track Karnataka Bank? What did you make of the numbers?
No, Neeraj, we don't track Karnataka Bank at all.
Okay, completely, I understand that. Never mind, 4 minutes left. Yogesh, stay on. Najaman, stay on. Minutes away from market open. Let's tell you all that you need to know to stay ahead in trade today. What will possibly mark the end to the Fortis battle? IHH Healthcare emerged as the winner for the company. It will infuse 4,000 crore rupees at a price of 170 rupees per share.
Watch out for HCL Technologies as the board has approved a buyback amounting to 4,000 crore rupees. Well, the buyback price of 3.64 crore shares is fixed at 1,100 rupees each.
Cyan reports weak June quarter earnings yesterday with profit coming off by almost 30% sequentially due to delays in certain projects.
Among other earnings today, Infosys, 3i Infotech and Bajaj Corp will be reporting their first quarter numbers.
In another step towards settling a 16-year-old matter, NCLT has approved the demerger of Tata Communications and Hemisphere Properties.
And in some key brokerage calls, IDBI Capital initiates a buy on Jamna Auto with a price target of 107, and HDFC Securities has initiated coverage with the buy rating on Radico Khaitan with a price target of 473 rupees.
You know, the stock that, of course, is in focus and the big news, we were talking about it first up on first one, and that's Fortis Healthcare. Yogesh, what did you make of the eventual victory by IHH Healthcare on the Fortis Healthcare assets? I mean, what does it mean for somebody who's invested in Fortis?
At least, Neeraj, I would say it would be a sigh of relief that after all this ruckus happening over the last few months, and now they've settled somewhere at the bottom now, and the downside would be limited again because the fresh infusion of the money will come, and the promoter, at least the handover to the next new management would be a better perspective, will put forth the better perspective. So there it will be a sigh of relief. Nevertheless, it will take a lot of time to recover from the businesses and the annual report numbers which they have diverged. So that will be again a hangover there, but would believe that around 170-180 is a good opportunity for investors to, you know, get rid of the stock and get into something better named portfolio names.
Okay, well, the pre-opening rates have settled down and we're looking at a opening of higher by almost 33 points. That's what the pre-opening rates are suggesting. Just a few counters which are moving around are Hathway Cable. Watch out for that. In fact, there could be some bit of respite coming by after the sort of correction that we've seen for all these stocks. But Yes Bank, Shrikant, I guess that counter was weak yesterday. Any view technically on that one?
See, Navneet, this stock was somewhere around 330, 335, reported very strong number in the previous quarter, went to 385, 390 levels. Hmm. From there, it is corrected. So I think if there is any correction, we should look for adding some long positions instead of taking any contra position of going short.
Okay.
So I think currently it is around 375. 370 is the best levels to buy for. Again, we can see the levels of 400 plus.
Okay, let's also get you the top trading call from our technical experts before the market opens. Raja, after looking at the pre-opening session, any specific call or you would stick to what you've given now?
I'll stick to what I've given right now.
So that would be KPIT?
KPIT and Bajaj Finance.
Bajaj Finance, both of them. Shrikant, what about you?
I think, see, apart from Mahindra and Mahindra and DLF, I would like to focus more on Tata Communications because yesterday it recovered very well in, towards the end. And the way there is a formation, I think we can see some technical rebound in next 1 or 2 days of time. So yeah, Tata Communication also looks good.
Plus, there's a news also that NCLT has approved the demerger of Tata Communication and Hemisphere Property. So the stock would be reacting to that one, Neeraj.
Well, okay, so those are the three calls from our experts. Do watch out for Tata Communications. KPIT, I believe, is what Raja was bullish on as well. So do watch out for both of these names. Shrikant, Raja, gentlemen, thank you so much for taking the time out and speaking with us today. It was great having you. Yogesh, just stay on. We'll take an opening thought from you post the market open. But here's how the market will start off trade today. Marginally higher in trade, about a third of a percent. The Nifty Bank not likely to participate too much if the pre-open rates are to be believed. So we'll probably have a flattish start to the Nifty Bank, yes, on cue. But about a quarter of a percent for the Nifty and the Sensex. So it's a good start for that end of the market. The mid caps and the small caps should come up on your screen. Underperformance yesterday in today's session, a flat start. Let's wait and watch if that lasts going ahead or no. Bring up the heat map. More green than red. HCL Tech, incidentally, starts off a couple of percentage points lower, and UPL continues to grind lower. That's another percent lost for UPL. 4% yesterday, 5% day before, another percent right now. Let's wait and watch for how long this lasts. But HCL Technologies, interestingly, starts off a couple of percentage points lower. I don't know if the market anticipated a price which was, as Agam was stating, between 15 to 20% of a premium, and the premium is only about 10%, but some bit of a disappointment or maybe some rally that had happened earlier any which ways. IOC, BPCL, HPCL, all three stay in the green. Infosys, yesterday's stop loser rises, Titan about a percent higher. But aside of that, not seeing too many moves in any large names. Bharti Infra playing yo-yo almost every single day, up a day, down the next. In today's session, Bharti Infra is down about a couple of percentage points. So, well, a muted start of sorts and a very, very flat number now on the Nifty and the Sensex. So not too much happening really as far as the large caps go. A couple of mid caps might be news, the likes of Cyient, for example. We should try and bring Cyient up on the screen for our viewers. That stock started off weak in the pre-open session and currently about 3.5% off. So IT is not having the best of starts, I must say, in the session today. Cyient too, down about a couple of percentage points. And lastly, want to bring up Fortis Healthcare and see what that one is doing in the session today. Well, 3.5% higher. Darshan was speaking about a pop. We've gotten a pop, albeit not a very large one, but 147, the price at about 170. Well, let's wait and watch if this builds on from where it is right now. Suffice to say, not a bad start right now for Fortis Healthcare. Navneet, what are you spotting?
Well, Neeraj, we just spoke to the management of Karnataka Bank, and that stock has reacted negatively to its numbers. In fact, we've seen a cut of almost 1 to 2% coming about in the opening session, though the management was sounding pretty bullish. IDBI Bank, remember, that's the one which has come out of the F&O ban, so that's also seeing cuts of nearly 3.5% in the opening session. Balkrishna Industries is the other one which is having a weak start to today, down 2% in trade. Remember, all the tire stocks were up in yesterday's session. Something like Sundaram Fasteners, that too is down almost 1.5%. Tata Investment is seeing cuts of almost 2% right now. On the gaining side, however, you've got a couple of stocks. GVK Power, Neeraj has been highlighting this counter, and Fortis Healthcare, obviously, post the news that IHH Healthcare has won the bid with 170, with the price of 170 rupees a share. Bajaj Corp, I think that's due for numbers today, 3% higher for that one. Do watch out for something like Marico. This counter has been taking very baby steps compared to the other FMCG stocks. It's not performed that well, and the reason is because the copra prices were inching high in the last few quarters, but in the last 3 months they have cooled off, hence on back of which we've seen some traction coming back in Marico. Yesterday there were some fresh longs, today also starting with gains of almost 3%, and Emphasis also starting the day with gain of almost 2% coming about. I want to pull up United Spirits. That's the stock which has been weak in the last two sessions when the markets have been trending high. United Spirits has opened with gains of almost 1% in trade. And finally, Jet Airways, if you could pull up that one, that's the new one which is into the F&O ban today. So just a flat opening for Jet Airways, 345.
Interesting. Yogesh, if we still have Yogesh Mehta, do we? Okay, we do have Yogesh. Yogesh, one final thought. I'm just looking at the start. We were talking about how IT is in the thick of things right now. HCL Technologies has started off a couple of percentage points lower. What's it? Was it expectation of a much higher open offer price, the size is higher, the price is not. Was it expectation of a higher price, or is it a case of there being a small rally ahead of the event?
Yes, Neera, there is a street has disappointed with the 1100 rupees because it was expected around, say, around 1150 plus. And the acceptance ratio would be again a key points to watch out for. So because it doesn't, you know, the way TCS has come out with the buyback offer in comparison to the same peer group. So that has a bit disappointment is there. And probably for on the fundamental note also, the business outlook is not that so great like Infosys and TCS at this point in time for at least FY 19 and 20. So they're utilizing their cash for the better managed on the balance sheet numbers on the key financial ratios. So that has disappointed a bit, and that would at least replicate into the stock price today.
Interesting. Yogesh, always good having you. Thanks much for taking the time out and being with us today. Really appreciate your time. Well, as we were saying, while the markets is still about a quarter of a percent point higher, Nifty Bank, the last four or five days, has almost been absent, conspicuous with its absence in major activity this week, at least, when the rally has been fairly buoyant. So let's wait and watch if it participates or no. But one is the participation within of specific pockets. Two is, how has the start of this earnings season been already? What are the expectations thereof? More importantly, what the texture of the market is looking like amongst institutional investors as well. Somebody who talks to a lot of them very, very closely is Nirav Sheth. He's head of institutional equities at SBI Cap Securities, joins us right now on the show. Nirav, before we talk about all of that, just a basic view from you of how are you seeing the texture of the market currently? I mean, we all know about the divergence between the performance in the large caps and the concentrated 5 or 10 versus the others. Probably extends to select mid caps as well. Do you see this continuing? Because while we may be sitting at new highs, portfolios are bleeding.
Yeah. So my view is that it's a boring answer, and I think the markets will be very, very boring in the current year, in a sense that if you look at even the earnings play out over the next year and a year after that, and if I look at the current valuations, then I don't think that you got any significant upside. So the latest piece that we put out, we are looking at a 6% upside from the current levels. And I'm giving a reasonably decent median PE multiple of 16 times on March 20 earnings. Wow. Importantly, you don't get a good case for even having a downside. So I think you're going to be in extremely narrow range. And what is probably going to happen is that you're going to see big churn. So, and I've been debating this for a while, I've been arguing this for a while, that the have-nots are going to perform. So I think your AB, that's the call that I've got. So I still find it extremely surprising that IndusInd Bank is almost in absolute market cap equal to an Axis Bank and stuff like that. So I think that will change. Now what the markets will do will largely be determined by what Axis Bank does, ICICI Bank does, SBI does, and what a Kotak does. If Kotak holds up to its level, then we are going to move higher. And if these banks move up and the other banks start going down, the markets are going to remain flat. But I think that is broadly the structure of the market. So if you look at the difference between, like you said, if you look at the difference between the Nifty and the equally weighted Nifty performance, the divergence is 11%.
Interesting. What do you mean by that?
So in a sense that if you, it's basically the large caps which are driving. So Reliance is driving large part of the Nifty gains, something like that. So it's not a very healthy participation in the market. So very few stocks are driving that.
Yeah.
Which has been a global trend. So they talk about the FANG and something like that. Absolutely. Yeah.
The question though, Nira, would be that, you know, as you said, it's global in nature. For the last so many years now, we haven't seen the ABBs, Gs on a global level. The market caps move up at all, right? It's been very, very specific names. So the new age companies, consumer facing companies are doing really well. The industrials, even if they are age old leaders, are not doing the same.
Sure.
Are we likely to see that happening in our markets too? The Bajaj Finances, HDFCs, HDFC banks of the world, maybe a Reliance of the old economy is doing well. Some of the others are not. Does that divergence stay?
I'm not very sure. So I'm saying is that when you look at, especially if you look at developed countries and if you look at something like FANG, we are talking about a structural change wherein they are getting a larger part of the profit pie, right? A large part of these earnings is explained by a very high profit to GDP ratio, right? So there's something different. So in US, you got profit to GDP ratio, which is I think close to 9 or 10%. The long-term average is 7% because they're getting a larger part of the profit pie, not only within the domestic shows, but also from abroad. Google does about $1 billion turnover a year. That means that a Z or someone else is losing that pie. In India, very strangely, you got profit ratios which are close to all-time lows. I think we're at about 3.6 or 3.7% against a median of about 7%. So in our case, it is a lack of earnings coming back. There it's about great companies doing very well,
okay,
and others are also running. So I think that we are likely to see that catch-up happening. I am very positive. So you look, you're looking at 6% earnings CAGR in Nifty over the last 4 years, which explains this bipolarity in terms of what does well, what doesn't do well. So it doesn't pain me not to own an Axis Bank. It doesn't pain me not to own an ICICI Bank. And therefore, you know, Bajaj Finance will be worth more than Axis Bank, right? And you've got a 5x gap in net worth. It has to change.
So I'm going to take your point on board. The rally that we've seen for Nifty has largely been polarized, and the kind of surge that we've seen in FANG stocks globally, do you think back home in India, there was a lack of opportunity then, and hence the reason why more money was moving towards IT, or there's a genuine recovery that one is witnessing in growth levels, earning levels?
So I think that you're likely to see recovery happening forward. I'm still not convinced that you are seeing a broad-based recovery. The reason is that, to me, there are two strong leading indicators. One thing is credit growth, right? Which is, you moved off the bottom, but you are just in 11-12% range. You cannot have an economy firing until you are growing at about 18-22%, which is what previous historic cycles would give you some indication. Second thing is profit growth. So now you are very hopeful that earnings will grow at about 23% is what we are expecting, right? That is the first leading indicator. I mean, appreciate the fact that you get excited about things, your animal spirits come back when I got profits, right? So if I'm looking at last 3 or 4 years and if I'm running as CEO of the company, I cannot get very excited about investments, stuff like that, if I don't have profits backing me up.
Correct.
So I think we look at lot many things, but the critical leading indicators will be credit growth, will be profit growth, and both of them have lagged. I think that needs to get corrected, and hopefully I think FY19 should be the initial block, but I still believe a full-fledged recovery is probably FY20.
So then, if you're betting on the credit growth, would you also bet on the banking stocks then?
Aye, banking stock is, to me, the most obvious place to be for the next 2, 3, 5 years. Not only because the growth is going to come back, mm-hmm, but like I've always mentioned that India's story is about massification of credit. It is about, you know, so you had all these guys, only 40, 45 million people getting access to credit, and that is changing in terms of, you know, the roadsides, stalls, restaurants, all these guys are being a part of the mainstream credit. That is going to drive credit. That is going to drive growth. So we have somewhere over there.
Where would you put your money, private or PSU? I know the answer because most of them are saying private.
I know the answer. You can answer for Nirav.
Absolutely. So I mean, my view is that the beauty about banks is that if you've got a sensible CEO with head on the shoulders, everyone will make money. You've got an AU Financial making money, Equitas making money, Yes Bank, SDFC Bank, Bandhan Bank. Irrespective of size of the balance sheet, you've got ROEs which are in the region of 16 or 18%. So it is not something that requires huge amount of skill. It's a modular structure. So yeah, you can pick and choose. You'll run short of money, not of ideas.
Very interesting. You know, I somehow get a feeling that for a lot of these guys like HDFC banks and the others, where the asset quality was never a problem, the management was able to focus on growing business in innovative ways to compete with what is arguably going to be a global war, right? I mean, what happens when Alipay comes in, etc.
Absolutely.
But the PSUs are saddled with trying to solve the worms in their own backyard. That customer acquisition and customer servicing somehow just takes a bit of a backseat. I don't know when does it come back. Anyways, the other pocket, Nirav, that has puzzled me, to be honest, is that with this whole conversation of MSP price increases, almost every fund manager that I speak to, they obviously don't comment on stocks, but they speak about how they want to bet on companies which will benefit from the rural spend. Now, the trend, if at all, is that almost everybody is betting on consumer names which will benefit out of this. So the select rural auto spend focus companies, etc., come into play. The pure play agri related stocks, I mean, UPL has, for maybe specific reasons,
sure,
been in turmoil. The seed companies, the pesticide companies have all been beaten down black and blue, or at least they haven't given any positive returns. What's ailing that space?
Precisely, which is why I'm saying that I don't see a broad-based recovery. So, I mean, if you just look at the latest IIP numbers, look at the PMI numbers, you got 2 months of growth and then 1 month of contraction in services, right? Which is unusual, which is why I'm saying is that it's not that you're firing. I am not of the belief that you are seeing a great broad-based rural recovery because the rural wages are still in about 5% range. And if I adjust for the inflation, therefore they are in negative territory. And when you last talked about the great rural recovery, they are growing in double digits, which is what led to inflation and stuff like that. So it is not something that gets me very excited. My conspiracy theory is that a lot of these companies, like consumer companies and all of them, have made tons of money by retaining a part of the GST gains that they've got. And the narrative that they want to pass on is the fact that there is a decent amount of rural recovery happening. So I am...
No, it's also
I think
in
it's
a low
in
base,
pockets.
Nirav, right? Because we saw demonetization.
That also plays.
The numbers were looking good because of low base.
Absolutely. But I think their margins have also expanded. And maybe, I don't have a great answer to it. So I speak to some of the companies. Some of the companies are saying that, you know, there is amount of pickup that is happening. But I mean, somewhere it has to add up, right? If I look at some macroeconomic statistics, it has to reflect somewhere, or else it is just a narrative, and it could be very company-specific thing. Someone is launching a new model, a new product, and that tends to do well. You get bullish on Maruti because Maruti gets products right, not because you're very excited about what is happening in the car industry. It's going at 12%, something like that. So it could be company-specific issues as well.
So you're not betting on the rural theme at all?
No, I'm not.
It's good to get contra views, Neeraj.
Yeah, we've
been seeing a lot of market participants betting, and not only them actually. I think the commentary from HUL in the last three quarters has been, we are seeing rural recovery. It's not back to what it was, you know, pre-demonetization level. So let's see whether that plays out or not.
There is some element. I'm not saying is that.
Rightly mentioned it has to be a double.
Yeah, so you've seen Mahindra doing well with their rural pickups, but that was after 4 years of almost a degrowth. So off some low base, you're seeing some sort of bump up that is happening. But like I said, you know, it becomes very apparent. For a broad base of companies, if you are talking about a real economy. Secondly, just look at the last CPI reading yesterday, right? The inflation surprised on the upside. Why? Because of food inflation, which is still 3%. That is basically my farm income, right? So then, what is the disconnect?
True. Okay. One factor, Nirav, and you have telling thoughts on this. By the way, just before we continue the conversation, want to mark, a couple of things. Bharti Infratel is now down 4%, by the way, viewers, so keep that at the back of your mind. And surprise, surprise, while HCL Tech may be doing what it is doing, the rest of the IT pack seems to have bounced back. Wipro is up a strong 3.5%. I guess once TCS announces or the first company announces a buyback, the belief is that everybody else will follow suit. HCL Tech has already done that. I don't know if it's that or something else, but Wipro is certainly revving up. The last few days, it's been one of the better performers. We already spoke to you about IT enough. Crude. You have a telling view there. There's a bit of a pullback, temporary as it may be, because Iran sanctions moving out or coming in rather might well put some bit of a lid on the downside for crude too. What happens to the crude sensitives? OMCs, if you have a view there, and something that I almost ask you every single time, aviation.
Right. So I think from the last time that we spoke to right now, I think our hypothesis was that your upside in oil should be kept, which I think is broadly playing out. And the worldview then was the fact that you got midterm elections coming in November, and then Mr. Trump likes to go and say that he's in charge of oil, and he tweets that, you know, I've spoken to Saudi Arabia and they could increase the spare capacity and stuff like that. So it seems that oil is likely picked at least till you are there into up to November or something like that, and they have increased, they cut the production quotas and stuff like that. Two things. First of all, in terms of the impact of oil on the broader macro. Inflation is YOY, not absolute level of oil. And we have already taken a big part of the increase so far. So last part of that gets reflected in my inflation. So there is no suppression of inflation because of oil prices. So we are done with that largely. And you are going to see softer numbers going forward. And if that is the case, then look at something like HPCL. You got normalized marketing margins today. So you price your petrol and diesel to an extent of $77, while the Brent is today about $74. So they are now getting back, they are already in a territory of normalized marketing margins, and your stock price are down 45% from the top, right? So that you've got a bigger play over here, right? So when I speak to some of the clients, most of the clients, there is a big resistance to us getting into PSUs. You pick up any chart of any PSUs, Bharat Electronics, banks, OMCs, they've all fallen off the cliff, right? So you simply, money just tend to move out of it, and because you're getting into political heavy calendar year and stuff like that. And therefore, I'm not sure in terms of how fast the sentiment can come back, but I'd be very surprised that year out, you're not going to make some serious money in these kind of stocks, which is what happens, which is what exactly happened in IT, that, you know, nothing happened and you're not done, dusted, and suddenly the stocks, I mean, TCS is up some, whatever, 25-30%, you know, talking about serious amount of wealth being created. I'm talking about large cap heavyweight.
Yeah.
Likewise, in aviation, traffic growth is held up. So some of the companies, the yields are holding up in terms of YOY, and the story remains good. But obviously, if the oil is likely to go down another $5, then the stocks will just fly. But I can't take a call on that. But even from here, current levels, you should get far more than your required rate of return in these stocks.
Let's hope for that. Nirav Sheth, always a pleasure having you. Thank you so much for taking the time out and being with us today on Bloomberg Quint. Really appreciate your time.
Sure.
And the markets on a flat, actually, no, not on a flat note, slightly higher. Yeah. Let's take a break on that note. On the other side, we get in a couple of corporate conversations. KR Constructions speaks about what's happened to the sector after NHAI has hit the brakes on orders. And a bit later on, Borosil Glass stock at new highs. We talk to the management in just moments from now.